And we will have a time in prayer. So mark your calendars for that event. It's going to be amazing. In our continuing efforts to pray for like-minded churches, today we are lifting up Flourish Church and their pastor, Dexter Harris. And Pastor Dexter is bringing the word to us today. And he's a part of the Chicago Partnership. And you'll learn a little bit more about him a little bit later. In lieu of what happened yesterday, I just want to take a pause and pray for our country. And it doesn't really matter what side you're on, and it's a shame that there's even sides, right? Because we are the United States of America. But we've gotten to this point where we are deeply divided. And so I want to take a pause and just pray for our country and pray for the people who were injured in yesterday's action. And also let's pray for Flourish Church as well. Will you join me in that? Lord, we thank you for the gospel and how you use it to change lives. We thank you for Flourish Church in Gary, Indiana, and what you are doing through their ministry and how it's impacting the surrounding communities. Lord, will you continue to provide all the needs of this ministry? May their staff and their pastor, Pastor Dexter, not grow weary in doing well, but I pray that they will persevere to reap the harvest that you've promised to those who are diligent in faith. And so, God, we thank you for Flourish Church. And God, we lift up our nation to you, our broken nation, a nation that has forsaken your word. God, will you draw us back to the truth of your word? Let that be the foundation of who we are here in the United States again, founded on in God we trust, not in men, but in God. And in trusting in you, we don't lead to our own understandings. We don't lead into anxiety when we see what happened yesterday come to the forefront of our televisions. We're not concerned, we're not angered, but we trust. So God, I just pray that you will heal those who were injured yesterday. But God, also I pray that you'll heal our nations. May your name be glorified throughout the nations. And we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. All right, Harvest, let's stand to our feet and worship the Lord together.
Testimony is the living proof. If you doubt the evidence that he is able, open your eyes, people, get ready. Just build an altar. Just a whisper. He calls the dead to walk out of the grave. Let the ones who he redeemed lift up a banner. Now is the time, people, get ready. Just build an altar. creation longs to have the words to sing. But this joy is mine. With a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs, and a thousand more. Who else would die for our redemption? Whose resurrection means our rise? There isn't time enough to see.
This out together.
A thousand generations are falling down in worship. Sing the song of ages to to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us, and all who will believe, we sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Come on, let's lift him up today, church. Your name. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name always stands above. Yes, it does. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name, it stands above them all, and the angels cry. Holy, all creation cries. Holy, you are lifted high. Sing the song forever to the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, sing the song forever to
the Lamb. Oh, we lift our voice, we sing this song.
We'll sing the song forever and amen, and the angels cry.
Holy, holy, holy. I'll take a pause for a second here. We worship a holy God, and we worship him with everything that we have. Not only our voices, not only our actions, but also with our money. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 and 7, it says this. The point is this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give what they have decided in their own hearts, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful worshiper, right? But then look at what it says. It says, and God is able to make all grace abound to you. This is in verse 8. So having been sufficient in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. But it starts with cheerful giving. We don't give to the Lord out of duty. We give cheerfully. We give because he's given us so much. He's entrusted us with the ability to get wealth. He's just asking for us to give a portion back to him. And so we have an opportunity to do that every Sunday and right now at this moment. So you'll see the different ways that you have to give here at Harvest. Let's pray for our offering. Lord, we thank you for the ability to get wealth. And so God, it is our prayer that what we give back to you is pleasing in your sight. Lord, will you use it to take the gospel further than we could have ever imagined? We thank you and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue to worship.
Out together, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. And there is no shadow of turning with thee, and thou changest not thy compassion. As thou hast been, thou forever will. We sing, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. The morning by morning, new mercies I see. And all every season, he's been faithful to us. We sing this.
Great is thy, oh great is thy. remember this today. He's a God who's pardoned our sin, gave us a peace that lasts forever.
Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thy own dear presence you cheer and to guide. Oh, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all.
Ourselves of this once again. Oh, great is thy faithfulness. Lift your voice.
Great is thy faithfulness. Oh, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath. Great is thy faithfulness, oh, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Yes, God, we thank you that you are faithful. Yes, you are faithful. Not all men. You've never left us. You've always been with us. Throughout all of history, we can see that you have been faithful. So we thank you for that. We praise you for that. We honor you for that. And we put ourselves, we surrender ourselves to you again. You've proven yourself trustworthy again and again and again. So we give our lives to you. Even in this moment, we lay our lives down at the altar and say, God, have everything of me so that you can get all the praise, you can get all the glory. Thank you for this time of worship, of singing about your faithfulness and singing how holy and worthy you are. We honor you, we worship you today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen. Come on, church, who's thankful for his faithfulness today? Come on, who's grateful that he's never left you yet, that he's still with us? Never given up. We worship you. Amen. What an amazing time of worship. Hey, if you're a junior high, or you are dismissed for junior high, everyone else, why don't you say hello to someone around you?
Well, good morning, Harvest. My name is John. I serve as one of the pastors, and this is Dexter Harris. We're so glad you're here today.
Glad to be here.
You know, Dexter, Harvest has a long history of church planting, and it's been exciting to see God do a work across our country and world through church planting. And You're here today because we are so thrilled about the work that God is doing through your church and the Chicago Partnership. That is one of the ways that the Lord is allowing us to move forward in church planting. And we are so thrilled to partner with Chicago Partnership. So tell us about your relationship with the Chicago Partnership.
Well, first and foremost, thank you all so much for having me this morning. A couple years ago, God called our campus out to become an independent campus. And so during that time, I was in prayer asking the Lord to give us some guidance and some people that can come alongside of us. I think it's important when you're embarking on something new to find people who've been where you're trying to go. And so the Chicago Partnership was just a great place for me to kind of learn and to get community around me and my family as we stepped out on a new adventure of planting a church in Gary, Indiana.
Great. Gary, Indiana, Chicago. You grew up in Chicago, though.
I grew up in Chicago. That's correct.
I went to Gary. Correct. And Derek grew up in?
In Gary.
And went to Chicago.
Yeah, so we swapped places.
Okay.
Yeah.
A little slow there.
God is funny like that. Sorry.
Well, great. Well, God has been doing a good work in Flourish. Yeah. And maybe you could just tell us an evidence of God's grace that you've seen over this past year or recent history at Flourish.
Yeah. So as we stepped out into being a church plant, God blessed us with a donated 20,000 square foot building to get some work started in Gary, Indiana. God has continued to show himself extremely gracious and to be Jehovah Jireh as we look out on Gary, which is the distressed community. We want to see Gary flourish again, hence why we named our church Flourish Church. And so we're just trusting God to continue to lead and to provide as we continue his work there in Gary.
Well, that's great. We're going to give you a chance to preach.
All right.
Can I pray for you before you do that? Father, thank you for this day. We stand before you, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and you know everything that you have for us on this moment, in this day, to be filled, to be nourished, and then to go out and be on mission for you. And so in this next moment that we have together, as we open your word, I pray that you would use Pastor Dexter in a powerful and bold way. I pray that your spirit would have the freedom to reign and to rule in each of our hearts, and that we would be a changed people because of what your word does to our hearts today. So bless him and use this moment that we have in your word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, Harvest Bible. Once again, I am glad to be with you this morning. In fact, I am Red Bull excited to be with you this morning. If you got your Bibles, go ahead and go to Psalms 121. That's Psalms 121. And when you're there, say amen. If you're not there, say hold up. That's okay, we won't judge you. If you're anywhere near the book of Revelation, you have went too far, you're gonna wanna paddle back just a little bit. While others are looking for scripture, let me deal with a little housekeeping. If you haven't sat under black preaching before, black preaching is dialogical, which means that there's a conversation that happens between the pulpit and the pew. Let me make it plain. If you feel like saying amen while I'm preaching, it'll make me preach faster, amen. Let's try to practice that together. Amen. And I warm up just a little bit. Psalms 121, if you would stand to your feet as we read God's word. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. You missed the amen right there. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out in your coming in. From this time forth, watch it now, here it is, and forevermore. You may be seated at this time. I want to preach from this thought. You can clap, that's fine. I want to preach from this thought for 17 and a half hours. Talk to God who protects you. Will you turn to the person next to you and say, person next to me? Oh, person, let's try this again. Turn to all the introverts in the room want to leave right now. Turn to the person next to you and say, person next to me? I don't know about you, but the God that we serve protects us. Oh, see, that neighbor is still sleepy. Turn to the other neighbor. Say, other neighbor, look him right in the eye now. Other neighbor, you're my last choice now. Don't fail me. I don't know if you know, but the God that we serve protects us. I run a small business specializing in car detailing and carpet cleaning. And I started this business in order to hire a young man in my community who kept asking me for $20. And I told them, I don't have $20 to give everyone, but I will teach you how to work. Whenever I have the opportunity, I like to assist my sister who manages them in providing our customers with satisfying services at their home. Now, it's not my intention to promote my personal business here. However, if you need our services, we are available. The reason for mentioning this business is to introduce a product we use called ScotchGuard. ScotchGuard provides invisible protection for fabrics by repelling liquids and stains, making it simpler to clean up spills efficiently. That's not all this invisible protecting cause ScotchGuard can protect against. It also protects against water and oil-based stains, mold, bacteria, and premature wear and tear. We offer customers the option to apply a safeguard because accidents can happen unexpectedly, regardless of how careful you are with your furniture. Whether you're single or married, have kids or no kids, own animals or not, life unexpected mishaps will and do occur. And when they do happen, you'll be grateful that you have this invisible protectant in place. It may seem unlikely at first glance, but depending on your household situation and dynamics, stains do happen. Grease from fried chicken and Kool-Aid. Just keep looking at me. If that didn't reach you, I'll try another angle. A casserole juice can get on a nice rug. All right, that may didn't hit some of you all. Let me see if I can get all the households. A taco juice can get on your couch. I want to make sure that we arrive at the same place at the same time. ScotchGuard understands that life is unpredictable, incalculable, and unavoidable. It acknowledges the fact that unexpected events can and will happen, and life doesn't necessarily give you a warning before it comes. That's why what we need most in such situations is protection to help mitigate potential damages or losses caused by unforeseen circumstances. However, not only does furniture like couches and love seats and rugs need protections from life, unpredictable and unavoidable events, we ourselves, if we're being honest this morning, require safeguarding in the face of life uncertainties. This is why I'm here today, to introduce, not ScotchGuard, but another reliable, invisible protection that serves as a sure defense for when life throws unexpected challenges your way, and if it hasn't happened yet, just keep on living. For instance, during times when financial issues arise, or things don't add up as they should, or as the young folks say this day, when the math is not mathing. Moments when our body starts showing signs of wear and tear. I'm 36, and the other day, my knee just started hurting. Out of nowhere, I used to work at a nursing home, and I read a book that said, getting old is not for wimps. I think there's some truth to that. You need a protection when that routine doctor visit that you just went for a simple checkup turns into an extended hospital stay. Struggles with mental health where anxiety and stress is overwhelming. Fluctuating moods and emotions are all over the place. You can't seem to ground yourself. Being blindsided by a relationship revelation through unexpected text exchanges. Situations that knocks us off balance after walking what seems like a steady path. Sometimes life can throw some things at you that are bigger than you, that far exceeds your strength. There's some things in life that'll challenge your faith, that will rock your world, that will make you question God at times. Can we be honest in this room? And yes, I know that this walk has sunny days. And I know there will be mind-blowing circumstances and walking on water moments and opening the eyes of the blind and transfiguration moments and people giving in abundance and great seasons of dreams and answered prayers and mind-blowing blessings and enemy-defeating moments. I know sunny days exist in life, but what I got up this morning to talk to you about is, what do you do when life throws curveballs your way? While Scotchgard cannot prevent life's unexpected, incalculable, and unavoidable events from happening, it does guarantee to protect you when they do occur. Now let me share with you our invisible protector, God. I can stop right there. That's enough all within itself. Our invisible protector, God. You see, the psalmist is intending to teach us that God himself, although unseen, serves as a protector for his people. Those who trust in the Lord have an all-sufficient protection against life troubles because God makes himself available for believers during inevitable challenges in life. I'm gonna play that back. I like the way that sounds. Those who trust the Lord have an all-sufficient protection against life troubles, watch this now, because God, the maker of heaven and earth, makes himself available to those who belong to him. And the superscription to this psalm tells us that this song is a song of degrees. This is a song that the worshipers would sing as they made their way to Jerusalem, as they made their way to church, as they called an Uber to get to the temple, as they hopped in their Camry or their Tesla and they made their way to church. This is the song that they would play on their way. I know some of us, maybe we can relate. You know, before you come to church, you try to get ready for it, right? Whatever radio station you were listening to Saturday, you turn to the Christian radio station. Yeah, just keep looking at me. On Sunday, you tune into Moody Radio because you're trying to get your mind focused. And so as the Israelites were making their way to Jerusalem to participate in the three great annual feasts, the Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacle, this is one of the songs that they would listen to. This is a journey song. It's not the rock band journey. It speaks of the dangers of a journey and of the help God provides to his people along the way. As we journey through life, you and I will encounter the spills of danger, along with the heavy traffic of trouble that comes in and out of our lives inevitably. It is crucial as these things happen that we have sufficient protection. Without adequate coverage shielding us, there is a risk not only of being damaged, but also potentially facing irreparable harm. What this psalmist knows is that life is dangerous, is that life is predictable. Jesus knew about this too. This is why he gives the parable of the Good Samaritan. And if you remember that parable, the Good Samaritan helped the guy who was beat up on the side of the road. Jesus painted that picture in Jericho, which was close to Jerusalem. There was danger on their way to worshiping God. Oh, but the good news of this psalm is the psalmist has discovered a reliable, inexhaustible, comprehensive, invisible protection in God. This psalm wants to reach down into your soul this morning and to remind you and to reassure you and to teach you that although God may not take you out of a storm, that God can make you weatherproof enough to endure the storm. So it reads, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? Now, most people think verse 1 is some kind of declaration, John, some kind of declaration of hope. Instead, it is the psalmist being honest about life. And I like when the Bible gets real about life. I love when the Bible is honest about life. Oftentimes in church, we can play church games and act like life doesn't happen to us, but it does. The psalmist is not looking to the hills for help in facing the problems of life. No, the psalmist is telling us that danger is lurking out there in the hills. And he says, where does my help come from? As the psalmist is thinking about his anxiety in the world and the way that it is changing, many of us can relate that the world is changing. There is so much tension and divide politically, racially. We are in some crazy times. And as those things are weighing down on us, we too can ask the question, where does my help come from? And then verse 2 shows up. And the psalmist answers his own question, and he tells us the source of his help. The psalmist answers his own question by reminding us that the Lord is our help. In other words, God doesn't send someone else to protect his children. God doesn't contract your protection out to Brinks or Ring or cybersecurity. No, God himself says that I protect my own children. I don't need help from anyone. I don't need to contract anyone. I myself protect my children. Let me say it for the people in the back. God, the creator of the universe, stands in the gap and say, I will protect my children. Now, this text assumes that you and I need protection. It is not trying to sway us or convince us. It assumes that we need protection. Child of God, this song reassures us that God can handle the things that are handling you. That's a word for someone right there. God is more than capable of managing whatever challenges you are facing. Friends, let this psalm affirm that God has the power to overcome any and every obstacle in your life. Friends, let this song seep down into the crevices of your soul and affirm that God has power to overcome the obstacles in your path. In other words, God is stronger than what is stronger than you. I learned a lesson about how important it is to have someone in your life that is stronger than the things that are stronger than you. I run a mentorship program on Wednesday nights where we take the young men in our community and we play basketball with them. A couple weeks ago, we decided to switch it up a little bit to give them some exposure of different things in life. And so my friend, he just opened his own gym, a strength training gym. And so I reached out. I said, hey, David, do you mind if I bring the young man to your gym? I would love for them to learn about strength training. And then can you take strength training and also show them how some of those concepts can also work in life? He says, no problem, Dexter, I got you. Y'all, we pack up in a van, we drive down there, we get to the gym. The whole time, all of them are in the van talking trash to one another. I can lift more than you. I can lift more than you. Dex, you're not even that strong. All of that crazy talk, right? And so I'm loving it because I can't wait till we get to the gym because I know it's about to go down. And so, in other words, if you have an arrogant teenager, take them to the gym. And so, long story short, we get on the bench press, and the young guy, he asks for two plates, two 25 plates. We put two 25 plates on there, and he gets under there, you all, and he picks it off the bar. He brings it down. He throws it back up. I'm impressed. I say, okay. He said, Pastor Dexter, throw two 45s on each side. I say, you got it, buddy. He picks it up. He gets it down. We got a problem, though. He can't get it back up. And he's struggling for a moment. You can tell that his pride is being crushed in a moment because he thought it was something that he was able to lift, but it was heavier than him. And what I notice is that his eyes begin to wonder. And when his eyes begin to wonder, he was not looking for those who had equal power to him, his peers. He started looking for me or David because he knew that he needed someone who had more power than himself to lift the thing that was handling him. Friends, you and I, when we are in trouble, when we are worried, when we begin to look everywhere at our bank accounts or our friends or our network. No, we need to look to God because God is able to lift the thing that is so a burden to you. God is able to do it. All he had to do is this. Help. I'm so glad with God, you ain't got to do magic tricks. You don't have to come up with a sophisticated prayer. All you have to say is, God, help. And God comes and he steps in and he rescues. Now, here's my question to the psalmist. Psalmist, how do you know that God is sufficient? How do you know that God is an inexhaustible, comprehensive protector? Well, if you read the text close enough, there's a particular word that is jumping up and down almost as I was studying, saying, preach me, preach me. Five times in this psalm, the psalmist identifies his helper as the Lord. The word is Yahweh. This is the covenant name of God. This name identifies, watch this now, lean in on this. This name identifies God as the self-existent, eternal, unchanging God who is overall, controls all, and is all in all. You didn't catch it. Let me run it back. This name identifies him as the self-existent eternal. That means that God was not created. This is the same question my daughter asked me, my seven-year-old daughter. Daddy, where does God come from, baby? God doesn't come from nowhere. God always was, always will be. He is not made. Then this word identifies him as unchanging. I don't know about you, but I just need at least a few things in my life that are unchanging, stable, and reliable. And when the psalm brings up the name Yahweh, what he's saying is that you got a God that doesn't change. And he's also saying that he's overall, which means that God is the top authority, that there's nothing outside of his jurisdiction, and that he controls all things. This name identifies him. And the God who keeps all of his promises, the psalmist considers his source of help in his worrying, in his anxiety, in his stress, and it brings it down a notch. He's reminding himself. He's talking to his own soul. You know, sometimes you got to talk to yourself. Don't answer yourself, but have a conversation. Itself. I remember doing this one time when LeBron James, and I was rebuked for saying this at the other service, that my favorite player is LeBron James. I hope that I don't lose any friends in the crowd. I love MJ. Do not get me wrong. We can talk about it later, but we need to stay focused on God's word right now. Amen, brothers. But there was a time when LeBron James was down 3-1 against Golden State. Oh, man, I'm telling you, it was a sad moment for me to see LeBron James down. No one really comes back from a 3-1. But what gave me comfort in that moment is that LeBron James was still on the basketball court. Friends, something happens in our souls when we remind ourselves where our help comes from and who's our help. Okay, maybe that didn't relate to you because you don't like LeBron James. I brought something else. I remember when Martin Luther King Jr., according to his own account, he experienced a moment of deep spiritual revelation while sitting at the kitchen table in January 1956 during the Montgomery bus boycott. In this pivotal moment, as Dr. King was feeling overwhelmed and burdened by the challenges of leading the civil rights movement, he recounted hearing an inner voice that spoke directly to his soul. Dr. King describes how God's presence seemed palpable as he spoke directly to his soul. Stand up for righteousness. Stand up for truth. And lo, I am with you to the ends of the age. Lo, I am with you to the end of the age. And Dr. King said a profound strength came up inside of him, and it reaffirmed his commitment towards what God was calling him to do. Friends, that is what happens when God speaks to our souls and reminds us that he is the source of our help. Something happens when we consider God in times of trouble. Now, it's one thing to know where your help comes from, the source, but whenever I am delivering this product called ScotchGuard, there's another question that comes up with our customers. They want to know, what is the scope of ScotchGuard? You see, the word scope refers to the extent or the range of assistance, support, or aid that is available to you. It signifies how much help is accessible and in what ways it can be utilized to address a particular situation or need effectively. When applying ScotchGuard, people always want to know, how long would it last and what can it protect against? Here's the bad news about ScotchGuard. ScotchGuard, you have to continually reapply ScotchGuard every 6 months, which means that you got to go to Amazon or your local Target or Walmart and buy a new bottle every 6 months. But friends, with God, this is not the case. You don't need to buy a new God every 6 months. The same God that protected you yesterday, 6 months from now, the same God who protects you day in and day out is the same God who will protect you today. Psalmist goes on to describe some of the things that God protects us from. He says he protects us from slipping. I love this because now the psalmist is stepping into our living room. He wants us to gather at the same table and drop our masks and have a conversation with one another. In verse 3, he says, he helps those who slip. This verse tells us that the Lord will not allow our foot to slip. God knows that as we journey with him, as we follow Christ, temptations will come. God knows that danger will come. God knows that there will be things that will rock our world and our situation. God knows that sometimes marriage can get a little bit rocky. God knows that employment can get a little bit rocky at times. And in those moments, what God promises is, although they may shake you, God will not allow you to slip beyond repair. We must remember that he is never avoiding us, but that God is always walking with us. And then if you look closely at verse 7 and 8, it talks about perseverance. All five of these words translate the same Hebrew word. It's a word that means to watch, to keep, to observe, to guard, to take, to have charge of. Let me read that over you one more time. I like that. What the psalmist is conveying is that this kind of protection looks like a person who watches over you, a person that keeps you, a person that guards you, a person that takes charge over you. When the Lord saved you, watch this now, he took responsibility for you. When God saved you, he took responsibility for you. When God saved you, he took responsibility for you. When God saved you, he took responsibility for you. When God saved you, he took responsibility for you. When God saved you, he took responsibility for you. And that's a big deal, because when the God of the universe, who created everything, says that I'm responsible for this, there will be times when we feel like giving up and giving in. But we need to realize that he has lifted us out of the miry clay of this world, set our feet upon the solid rock of his power and glory, and he has established our goings. We are constantly being reinforced and held steady by the mighty hand of God. God's protection, friend, never wears off. Even when we are weak, he is strong. Even when we take on more, he says, bring it on. Anybody in the room ever been in that place where you ran out of power and all of a sudden some divine power rose up inside of you and sustained you and re-energized you? There are times when we grow weary and we want to rest. There are times when we let down our guard and get caught napping. There are times when we are not on guard. And the psalmist says that God will not sleep or slumber. I remember one time pacing my living room floor worrying. And I remember the Holy Spirit whispering quietly in my soul, Dexter Harris, there's no need for both of us to be up. In other words, God is saying, why are you trying to figure it out when I've already worked it out? Oftentimes, God is saying, go to bed, child of God. I got this. Do you know that God can still work while you're sleeping? I know how it is. God, but I have a plan already. God, we don't have to do this long. I already have this. God is saying, no, go to sleep. I got this. I created the world. I know what I'm doing. He is ever awake. He is ever active. This is the kind of God that we serve. And the other question that customers ask when we introduce this product called ScotchGuard, what does it protect against? We like to make sure that they understand completely and fully everything that it protects against. It's the same thing that the psalmist is trying to do as you begin to study this psalm. You can tell that the psalmist is now reaching for words. He's trying to find words in English, in Hebrew, in Aramaic, and what he's finding is that there's not enough words in the dictionary to wrap around the fullness of God's protection when it comes to his children. He's trying as best he can. He's striving, but words are falling exhausted at the feet of God's protection. And so he goes on and he says, well, let me try it this way. Not only does he do great and mighty things, but he protects you from your enemies. Amen, amen, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Somebody, anybody got enemies in the room? If they sitting next to you, just keep looking right at me. Because if you cut your eye a little bit, they're gonna know. This verse tells us that the Lord is our shade upon the right hand. Okay, that didn't really move you, but if you do your homework, it moves you a little bit more. Here it is. In ancient times, warriors carried two items into battle. One was the sword, and the other was the shield. Normally, the shield was carried on the left hand and the sword on the right side. This meant that the right side was vulnerable to attack since there was no shield of protection upon it. The psalmist is telling us then, in a poetic way, that God deliberately takes up defense where we are weak. Didn't shout. Let me try it again. God deliberately takes up defense where Dexter Harris is vulnerable. In other words, God is paying attention to my weaknesses. That God is attentive enough that God knows the things that I am open to. God knows the ways that the enemy wants to fire his arrows at my life. And God says that I stand in position and I protect you against the very things that you are weak against. The whole point of this, we will be attacked. And we never know where the attack will come from. But it never catches God off guard. Oh, but he's still grappling because he's yet to fully explain to you the extent of God's protection. He goes on in verse 6, in so many words, he says that God protects us from the elements. I need to slow down and pause here because I really got to teach this part. This is the part that made me almost flip my laptop over and run a lap in my living room. In this verse, the psalmist speaks of two possible sources of harm that were common to the ancient soldier. One was sunstroke, a dangerous condition where the body became overheated and shut down. The condition could be fatal. But here's the one that got me. The other one was a moonstroke. Now, I never heard of anybody being moonburned. I'm usually not concerned with the moon. But that's not what the writer is getting at. If you understand the culture believed by the ancients, to the sun was also dangerous. A moonstroke, unlike sunstroke, did not affect the body, but it affected the mind. In ancient time, mental illness was thought to be caused by the moon. This is where we get the word lunatic. If that resonates with you, keep looking at me. To refer to someone who has mental disturbance. And what the psalmist is getting at is, not only is God powerful enough and sufficient enough to protect you from what's out there, but God is able to protect you from what's in here. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I can be my own worst enemy and I can be my own worst critic. And I don't need a God that can only protect me from out there, but I need a God that can stand up and protect me when my own mind is attacking me, when my own emotions and I can't get them under control. I need a God that can work on the outside, and I need a God that can work on the inside. And friends, I came to tell you that the God that we serve is able to regulate your mind in such a way that he'll give you peace that you never heard of. He'll give you joy that you never heard of on the inside of you. This is the whole idea. While we are subject to attacks in our lives, we are also subject to attacks in our bodies and in our mind. However, just as God will guard us against the attacks of the enemy from the outside, he will guard us from the attacks of the inside as well. When the heat is on, he will be there to shield us and guard us. And when our minds are under attack and filled with fear and doubt, he will be there to protect us and to give us peace. Friends, I guess all I'm trying to say is, no matter what you're going through or concerned about, seen or unseen, God has you. Are you concerned about the upcoming election? You see, it got real quiet in here, didn't it? Don't worry, I'm not going there. But I want to say this, that God got us. Because if God can keep us from 1789, from Washington to Biden, God can keep us in this moment, in this hour, at this day, at this time. Are you concerned about the economy? Can I tell you that God got us? The same God that fed Israel, that camped in the desert and he rained manna out of heaven, is the same God who will get us in 2024. The same God that walked on water, opened the eyes of the blind, fed 5,000 with a Lunchable, is the same God who protects and shields us today. He is the same God who rose from the dead, the same God who has all power in his hand, the same God who theologians say has ex nihilo power, that's out of nothing power, the same God that looked out on nothing, saw nothing, but by the time he spoke, there was something. This is the same God that the psalmist is looking for absolute protection. I know, I came ready for you. I know what the last question is. Same question my customers asked me at the end. After I told them the source of our protection, which is Scotchgard, and I tell them the scope of the protection, there's only really one last question that they ask me. You know where I'm going. They always ask me this question: how much is it going to cost? That's the final question, ladies and gentlemen. How much does this protection cost? You know why they make that inquiry? Because you and I know this, that good protection costs. Ring cameras cost. Smith & Wesson, keep looking at me, cost. Bodyguards cost. Insurance cost. So pastor, be honest with us, be transparent with us, be open with us. How much does this invisible divine protection cost? Friends, can I tell you that it'll cost you nothing?
If that doesn't make you shout, if that doesn't make you stand on your feet, I ain't got nothing else. Can I say it one more time? It'll cost you absolutely nothing. Zero. It's free.
But before we shout, although it costs you nothing, it costs him everything. It costs God everything to protect you. It costs his son nails in his hands and nails in his feet and a crown of thorns on his head in order to shield and protect you. It costs God everything to protect us. And to bring this point home, I want to close with this illustration. A few years ago, went to my insurance agent, and I said, I'm ready to purchase some life insurance. She said, good, Mr. Harris, we're going to take real good care of you. She set me down, you all, in a leather chair. I don't know why when people are getting ready to sell you something, they want to get you nice and comfortable. But ladies and gentlemen, I was on my toes. She laid out the various packages, and I like to describe them like this. She had the platinum, she had the gold, she had the silver, and she had the bronze. She laid them all on the desk. I said, you can remove the platinum. I can't afford that one. Let's talk about the gold and the silver. She began to explain to me the coverage of each of these. And I said, I'll go with the gold today. Where do I sign? She said, no, Mr. Harris, you don't sign yet. For this kind of package, we have to send a nurse out to your home to make sure that you're healthy. You know how insurance companies are. And so the nurse comes to my home, nice lady, real sweet. She rings the doorbell, ding dong. Hello, Mr. Harris. Hey, how are you doing today? I'm here for your physical. Come on in. I'm feeling healthy as a horse. And so she comes in, you all, I do the physical, and I say, all right, nurse, where do I sign? She said, no, Mr. Harris, you can't sign yet. I have to draw your blood. I said, well, go ahead, do what you have to do. And so she draws my blood. And then I say to her, you got my blood. There's no way you're getting out of this house unless I'm signing something. We're family at this point. She said, no, Mr. Harris, if the blood comes back good, we'll cover you for a lifetime. You missed your shout, but I'll bring it to you. Friends, what I'm trying to tell you is that God's blood came back good, and God says, I'll cover you for a lifetime. I'll cover you for a lifetime. I'll cover you for a lifetime. But friends, here's the kicker. My blood couldn't have been that good because I pay a bill every month to remain covered and protected. But can I tell you that the blood of Jesus is so good, not only does it cover you, you don't pay a bill ever again. It covers you in life and it covers you in death. It's the best life insurance I've ever had. And all those who trust in Jesus, all those who put their hope in Jesus, God says, although you die, yet shall you live. That's the kind of protection that I need. That's the kind of protection that you need. A protection that protects us even against death. Friends, can I say this to you? That all the people who have bought that Scotch Guard, they move different than the people who do not. They're not as worried. They're not as concerned about life's mishaps and uncertainty. They have a sort of peace about themselves because they have an invisible protection. And can I say that Scotch Guard ain't got nothing on our God. Amen. Be at peace and be at rest. Pray with me this morning. Father in heaven, God of all grace and mercy, protector of your people, sufficient, inexhaustible protection. Father, rest upon the hearts and the souls of your people. Whatever worry or anxiety that we have, I pray, God, that it would disappear as at the thought of how great you are. Lord, if you can create the mountains and the rivers and you can make rivers in the deserts, Father, we believe that you are faithful. And we say to our souls, great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto us. May your grace and your peace go before us. In Jesus' name I pray, and everybody who believed that said, amen. Amen. Would you stand and worship with us one more time?
What an incredible message today. Let's respond by singing and worshiping and giving glory to the one who is a living hope. Let's sing this out together.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living home. Yes, you are living home. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of
the cross. Deserves the highest praise. Lift your voice, clap your hands.
deserve all the glory, all the honor.
Woo! Wow, Harvest, you're covered. You're covered. I really love the analogy that Pastor Dexter used with the invisible protection, the starch guard. Starch guard, thank you. But if you think about it, if you're approaching a nice white plush couch, you might approach it with boldness if it has starch guard. Boldness with a big bowl of spaghetti, right? You're not afraid or not concerned if your clothing is dirty, right? As Christians, we have this invisible protection that should make us more bold, that should make us come as we are, right? That should make us not fearful over what we see in the news or what we see, as the pastor said, in our bank accounts. Those who have put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ should be the boldest risk takers, because God has done it all. He's accomplished victory on the cross for us, so that no matter what we face in this life, we should not be shaken. We should be bold for Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. Because we have invisible protection that makes us bold for Him. He's already paid the price, guys. We're not fighting for the victory. We're fighting from the victory, because our Lord has already won. So let's live like it. As we go out on mission for Christ this week, let's be bold. Let's be without fear, knowing that we are loved. All right? Have a great week, Harvest.